I have done that.
Yeah, is it recording now?
Yes, it's recording now.
But again, it's I think it is not reflecting on everyone's side.
It's reflecting here, and I think kids are also saying me yes.
Ah, yes, I can see that. Right? Oh, yes, started now. Yep.
Okay, fine. Yes, so we were talking about some division of marks, right? So your comprehension type of question, like case study based questions, those are going to cover 25% of the total marks, right? Then another 25% is going to cover with the writing skill and grammar. Okay, so you have to be very careful while writing sentences, okay, while writing your answers. You can't avoid some, you can't miss some words, you can't leave incomplete sentences, okay? So because after all, that is going to cover your 25%, right? Next, 50% is going to cover from your textbook, right? Literature textbook and the knowledge, what you have, what are you going to represent in your writing book, okay, in your exam. So pay attention properly in all these aspects, okay? Okay. Yeah, this is in English, but this weightage will be applicable for science also. No, this is not only for English, okay? This is the general, like, what should I say, for physics, chemistry, biology, science paper, okay? Yeah, okay. Now, okay, what is the pattern of the question? What is the pattern of your paper? So, your full paper would be divided into four parts, four sections, A, B, C, D, right? A section will have all the MCQs, 1 to 20, objective-based question. In that, you will have some MCQs, some assertion and reason types of question. Okay, basically, each question will carry your one mark. Now, section B. In section B, we will have short six answer type questions, okay, carrying two marks. Then in section C, we have three marker questions, right? Here we have seven questions. And in section D, we have three long answer questions, okay? Here your comprehensive type of question must be there. Maybe 1 second. Yeah, okay, sorry. So in section D, you have all five marker questions. Passage reading, case study type of question, everything would be here, okay? So today we are going to start our revision from acid, bases and salt. In this chapter also, you have the division, mark division criteria is approximately 1 plus 1 plus 3. Okay, or sometimes this would not be there. You will have directly five marker of passage reading questions. So you have to pay attention in each and every theoretical part of this chapter. Meanwhile, we will do some questions also here, the past year questions, and we will discuss how to solve case study sort of questions and assertion and reason types of questions. Okay, yeah. Okay, so let's start. Yeah, acid. We all are very well aware about the acids, right? So Liebig defined acid as a compound which contains what? Which contains one or more hydrogen atom, replaceable partially or completely by metal, right? To produce a salt. Okay. Is it only the metal? The hydrogen atom can be replaced only by metal? Okay, Aditya, no, Surya, no. Then which other thing can replace your hydrogen? Manisha, okay, no problem, fine. Salts can replace, is it? Okay, no. Surya, see here. Any acid, suppose you have HCl, you have H2SO4, okay, so what do we have? We have these replaceable hydrogens, okay? These hydrogens can be replaced by metals, okay? If you have any metal here, then this metal is going to make salt, like MCl, MCl2 maybe. M is just a random metal, okay? Aditya and Prateek, you are saying base. Okay, we'll discuss. Yeah. Okay, next. What is here? We have sulfate. So MSO4, correct? Let's see how base HCl plus NaOH. So what's happening? This hydrogen is going to replace by this sodium, correct? So it gives NaCl and H2O, right? So ultimately what's happening? Hydrogen is going to replace by a base, right? Yes. Okay, so Liebig defined that the compound which contains one or more hydrogen atom replaceable partially or completely by a metal to produce salt, okay? Then acids are the substances which have sour taste, right? They have sour taste. They turn blue litmus to red. Yeah, they turn blue litmus to red. So the short form I have given you guys, if you remember, ABR, correct? Acid turns. Guys, is this pen color okay? Is okay, I think this green one is better. Okay, Aryan, I just saw your message. Wait, okay, wait, we'll discuss. ABR, what I'm saying, ABR, that means acid turns blue litmus to red, right? Blue litmus solution, blue litmus paper to red. Okay, yeah. Aryan, but Na is a metal. Ha, huh, Aryan, that's why I told that that metal is only going to replace a hydrogen ion from the acid, right? The same thing only I told Aryan. Okay, yeah. So, ABR, that means acid turn blue litmus to red. Done. Now we will see some common examples of acids. Here I have written common mineral acid. What does it mean by mineral acid? What are the examples of mineral acids? The acid which can be prepared by minerals, right? Which is available in the form of minerals, which can be prepared by minerals, right? Okay, good. Correct. So mineral acid examples are HCl, H2SO4, HNO3. Yes, very good. Correct. And H2CO3. You know? Yes. H2CO3. Okay. H2CO3 is the carbonic acid. Right? Okay. Out of all these four acids, you know, all these three are strong acid. Strong acids. Right? Only the one weak acid, only the one carbonic acid is the weak acid, right? Correct. Good, Aryan. Very good. H2SO4, HCl, HNO3, HSO3, H2CO3, aqua regia. Good. Very good. Yes. Aqua regia is what? Aqua regia is combination of HCl and HNO3, right? And what do we say aqua regia? What is the common name of aqua regia? What is the common name of aqua regia? Royal water or king's water. Okay. Yes, regal water is also there. Correct. Royal water, king's water. And the combination or the composition, I should say, 3:1. That means you have three part of HCl and one part of HNO3. Okay. This is the aqua regia. Okay. Good guys. Very good. Yes. The ratio is 3:1. HCl and HNO3. Three part of HCl and one part of HNO3. Right. Any doubt in aqua regia? No. Okay. Okay. Next. So we were talking about some common mineral acids. Now let's see some common organic acids. Okay. Organic acids means what? Organic acids are the acid which we obtain from living
things. Natural substances.
Very good. Natural substances, some living organisms, decay of some organisms, right? Okay, good. So examples of organic acid, still so many people are joining.
Acetic acid.
Very good. Acetic acid.
Ethanoic acid.
Ethanoic acid.
Oxalic acid.
Wait. I have to write all of this. Oxalic acid. Okay. And acid, ethanoic acid, acetic acid and ethanoic acid is the same thing, right?
Acid, yes, ma'am.
And yes, correct. Good. And ethanoic acid is the same thing.
Lactic acid, oxalic acid.
Oxalic acid.
Lactic acid.
Lactic acid.
Tartaric acid.
Tartaric acid. Yes, Manisha, formic acid, Avni, tartaric acid. Yes, Shobita, methanoic acid. Very good. Formic, wait. Formic acid, then.
Malic acid.
Malic acid, very good example. 1 minute. Methanoic acid. Hey, formic acid and methanoic acid is the same thing, yaar. Yeah? Okay. What else?
Malic acid.
Yes, malic acid, then. Ascorbic acid, Aditya. Yes, ascorbic acid. Okay, citric acid, isn't it? And guys, do remember, citric acid and ascorbic acid, not the same thing, okay? Citric acid. Nitric acid, Navya. No, beta. Nitric acid is in mineral acids, HNO3, right? Yes, yes. Here we are going through organic acid. It's okay. Okay, then you know some uric acid. Have you heard about it? Uric acid, folic acid, right? Where do you get folic acid? You all are aware, okay? Where do you get folic acid? What is the source of folic acid? Pyruvic acid, yes, yes, correct. Pyruvic acid is also the example, correct? Guys, do you remember the source of folic acid? Just use your general knowledge. You know where do we get folic acid? No, not the follicles, no. It is related to vegetables. In ants, we have formic acid, this one. Oleic acid we have in olive oil. Okay, oleic acid is also the good example. Folic acid, you know, folic acid we get from green and leafy vegetables. Green and leafy vegetables. Yes, yes. Akshita, correct. Very good. Ascorbic acid is a vitamin C. Okay, mostly people get confused in between citric acid and ascorbic acid. Okay, guys, come back to the point. Stop discussing here. One second. Still some people are joining. Yes. Okay, so we have got so many organic acids. Okay, let's discuss the sources of these acids. Let me check if I have written everything here. Yeah, I have written. Okay, so in vinegar, what do we have? In vinegar, we get acetic acid, right? Acetic acid, correct. In oranges and lemon, we have citric acid and some amount of ascorbic acid as well. Okay, so citric acid. Then in tamarind and grapes, tartaric acid. Good. Huh? In tomato, which acid we have?
Oxalic.
Very good. Good. May I know who has answered me on the mic?
Prabhat Kumar, ma'am.
Okay, Prabhat. Correct answer. Aditi, yes. Aditi, shares Aniket, oxalic acid in the tomato. Correct. Then sour milk.
Yes.
Yes, lactic acid in sour milk, right? So, okay, the next in ant sting, bee sting, and hair of nettle plants, methanoic acid or formic acid, correct? Right? Who is not on mute? Children, please keep your mic on mute, beta. Okay. Yes, formic acid or methanoic acid, okay? Both are the same thing. They have same molecular formula. Okay? Yes. Next, what we have? Olive oil. We have oleic acid, right? Yes, Aryan, Navya, Purva, correct. Oleic acid. Then, in gastric juice. Yes, very common acid, HCl, right? HCl, correct. Then what is remaining? Apple, yes, apple. Tell me. Neha, Akshita, yes, correct. Malic acid. Very good. Next. One minute. Somebody asked me some question. Aryan, ma'am, it's a mineral acid. Oh, Aryan, HCl is the mineral acid. I know what is, I know your doubt, okay? It's a mineral acid, okay? Aditya, yes, ascorbic acid. Source of ascorbic acid is the citrus fruits, okay? Yeah, vitamin C, citrus fruit. The best source is kiwi. Yeah, okay. Next, in fat, do you know in fat which acid is available? Yes, Aniket.
Fatty acids.
Fatty acid is there, but they have more specific name. Stearic acid, or if you don't remember any name, then you can write fatty acid as well. No problem in exam, okay? Stearic acid or fatty acid, fine. In rancid butter, which acid do we have? In rancid butter, we have butyric acid. No, beta. Lactic acid we have in sour milk, okay? Yes, butyric acid. Good. Aryan, it's okay. It's just for your knowledge. Okay. Yes, I think these things are, you should have not taught in the school because obviously it's not given in NCERT textbook. But knowledge is always good for health, yaar. Right? Okay.
Uric acid.
Very good. Uric acid. Then, fresh fruit and vegetables. This is important, guys, okay? I don't know whether you guys have learned it before or not. In fresh fruit and vegetables, which acid is available?
Malonic acid?
Malonic acid. No. In fresh fruits and vegetables, we have high content of vitamin C, ascorbic acid. Okay? Ascorbic acid. I should have written here. This is the short form of acid I'm writing here, okay? You don't use in your board exams. Yes, in all fruits and vegetables. Yes, Akshita, correct. In obviously, if I talk about apple, so in apple, the major constituent, you will have malic acid, but you will have vitamin C as well over there. And then the highest source of the vitamin C or ascorbic acid is kiwi. Okay. Oh, good question. If I'm pronouncing your name right, Ralph. Ralph, is it right?
Mom, it's Ralph.
Okay, well, okay, yeah. So, Ralph, your question is, butter comes from milk. And why it doesn't contain lactic acid? Okay, very good question. So, see, you know, lactic acid is the constituent of what? Sour milk, right? Okay, and butter has a different composition. But we are not talking about butter here. It is rancid butter. That means, you know what? When your butter reacts with the atmospheric oxygen, it converts into butyric acid. Now, again, the question, what is the composition of butter? So butter is having a long chain of hydrocarbon, not like petrol and all those things. Okay, but butter and oil has a long chain of what? Hydrocarbons. It is unsaturated sort of. Okay, so when it reacts with atmospheric oxygen, it converts into butyric acid. Okay, unsaturated hydrocarbon. It converts into what? Butyric acid. That's why we are using the term here, rancid butter. Okay, Navya, what happened, beta? Repeat, okay. So butter, ghee, what should I say? Oil, all these things are made up of what? Long chain of hydrocarbon, okay? So they have different constituents, right? The oil is saturated hydrocarbon, ghee is unsaturated hydrocarbon, okay? So when ghee or butter reacts with the atmospheric oxygen, it forms butyric acid. It forms butyric acid, okay? Right? And milk is not the composition of long chain hydrocarbon. That is why there are different acids in milk and butter, okay? Milk is the part of what? Fat and water. That fat has a different carbon atom chain. Okay, Ralph, beta. Good question, by the way. Next, green and leafy vegetables. You know now. Okay, tell me, which acid do we have here? Folic acid. Yes, correct. Folic acid. So you should eat so much of green and leafy vegetables.
Ma'am, even oxalic acid is there in green leafy
vegetables. Yes. Oxalic acid is also there. But, you know, in leafy vegetables, we have major content of folic acid. If you ask with your parents also, they might have heard somewhere, if some person has deficiency of iron, doctor suggests them to eat spinach and fenugreek leaves. Okay, why? Because they are rich in the content of folic acid. And folic acid helps to increase iron. Right? Yes, correct. Fenugreek is methi. Aniket, yaar, I don't know what to say in other language. Yeah, it's methi. Hey, guys, do you know there is one area, Methi Keri, in Bangalore? So I heard that is their area is based on the name of methi, is it? Methi Keri, something like that. Really? Seriously, no, Surya? Oh, okay. Kere means lake. Okay. Then it must be having some different reason. Okay, coming back to the point. Yeah, so wood. Yes, correct. We forgot this bark, wood, and tree. Tea. In this, we have tannic acid. Okay, tannic acid. Okay, now we are done with all the acids and their sources. We have to do so many things. So now we need to increase our speed. Basicity of an acid. Basicity or protocity of an acid. Okay. Yeah, Arun, I got it. Basicity of an acid. What does it mean? Basicity, that means the number of replaceable hydrogen atom in one molecule of an acid. Okay, or the number of hydrogen atom which can neutralize hydroxide ion from the base, right? That is known as basicity of an acid. Remember? Okay, so now according to the basicity, that means what? How much hydrogen ion, replaceable hydrogen ion is present in your acid. True? Right. According to this definition, we have different kind of basicity of the acid. Right. Let's say we have monobasic acid, we have dibasic acid. I can say that monoprotic or monobasic, anything is fine. Okay, monoprotic acids or monobasic acid, anything is fine. Then diprotic acids and polyprotic acids. Right? So, now monoprotic acid, we all are very well aware, right? HCl, HNO3, HI, HBr, anything is fine, correct? These are what? Monoprotic acid. Now, diprotic acid, H2CO3, Navya, yes, but the classification has came in the previous year board exams. Basicity of the acid and what should I say? Classification of acid based on the basicity or protocity. Yeah. Okay. So if you have done in your school now, then it's better to go with that. Okay. Yes, I know that it's not there. Okay, let's continue. So diprotic, we were talking about H2SO4 and 1 minute. H2SO4, yeah. H2SO4, H2CO3 and another acid. If you guys remember, help me. H2SO3. Okay. Just pay attention here. See, now I'm going to write some new acid examples, okay? H2SO3, this is diprotic acid, okay? H2SO3. Now, next what we have, polyprotic acid. In polyprotic acid, best example, we have H3PO4, phosphoric acid. Please pay attention here now, okay? H3PO4, I have written in the column of what? Polyprotic acid. That means it has, why I have written it like this? Because it has three replaceable hydrogen atom, right? Three hydrogen ion can replace or can neutralize your three OH negative ion from the base, right? Okay, now if I write here H3PO3, what is the basicity of H3PO3? This is phosphorus acid. Yes, that's the important thing here, okay? H3PO3 should comes under the category of diprotic acid, okay? Okay, it is diprotic acid because only two hydrogen can be released from here. 1 second, guys, another window has got open by mistake. Okay?
Well, can you explain again basicity of an acid?
Sure. Basicity of the acid means what? The number of replaceable hydrogen atom in one molecule of an acid. Here, you can say basicity or protocity of an acid. Okay? So, number of replaceable hydrogen atom in one molecule of an acid. For example, HCl. In one molecule of HCl, it can give only one H plus ion. So its basicity is what? Only one. Why? Because this hydrogen ion, only it can neutralize only one OH negative ion. Is it right? This hydrogen ion can neutralize only one OH negative ion. So the basicity of this acid is OH negative. You know what? Ideally, what is the meaning of basicity? Basicity, that means the hydrogen ion released from an acid which can neutralize the hydroxide ion released from a base. Okay? Which can neutralize the hydroxide ion released from a base. Right? So, one molecule of HCl can neutralize how many molecules of a base? One mole or one molecule of HCl can react with only one molecule of a base, NaOH. Right? Or it can neutralize only one hydroxide ion. Right? This is basically our basicity. How can you write it in the exam? So any definition you can follow. The first one is what? Number of replaceable hydrogen present in one molecule or number of hydrogen ion produced in an aqueous solution by one molecule. Anything you can follow, right? Prabha, did you understand now? Okay. Good question, Aditya. We will discuss when we talk about the strong and weak acid. Okay, we will discuss this. Okay. Yes, next. One second. Any other doubt related to basicity? Any other doubt, any question? Aslesha, okay. Kulsum, okay. Kulsum, if I'm pronouncing it right. Aditya, Pratik, I need answer from all of you, beta. I'm waiting for your messages. Guys, what are you doing? Are you sleeping? Good. Rudpurva, if I'm pronouncing it right, this topic is important for board. So I can't say very important for board because I have seen just one question in past 10 years of the board exam paper, but I feel if the question is there, it's better to learn, right? And even the question was related to H3PO4 and H3PO3, something like that only. So Purva, if I can tell you Purva, is it fine? Purva, do you have any doubt? Did you understand what is the meaning of basicity, beta? Okay. Now we will see some uses of acids in which we are very well comfortable. You all know uses of all the acids, right? But here we are also going to discuss some important uses which you might have not studied or which you might have forgotten. Okay, so let's see here. Now some uses of acid. The first one is hydrochloric acid. Tell me some very rare use of hydrochloric acid.
It is used for making oxide films from steel objects.
Very good. Correct. Yes. Good. Correct.
Then it is used for making dye stuffs.
Dye stuffs. Correct.
Aditya, textile.
Yes. Yes. In textile industries. Correct. So what are the uses? Uses we have the very common use, cleaning metallic items. Cleaning metallic items. Then
dye stuffs, textiles, yes. Food and leather industries.
Very good. In tanning industries and in printing industries. You know, in printing industry also, we use hydrochloric acid for the dye purpose, okay, or for the tanning purpose, you can say. Printing industry. Okay, next, sulfuric acid. So the most popular use of sulfuric acid
for making of fertilizers.
Yes, most important use of sulfuric acid.
Production of fertilizer.
Wait. Sulfuric acid is mostly used in car batteries, and nitric acid mostly used in fertilizers and explosives. Okay, somebody was telling me, wait, who was there? I can't see the name. Okay, somebody was asking me TNT, the hydrochloric acid can be used in preparation of TNT. TNT is trinitrotoluene. Okay, so hydrochloric acid, no, we use nitric acid, okay, in explosives. I'll come to that point. So first, sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid we use in fertilizers. Yes, Aniket, we can make sulfuric acid from the sulfuric acid. Fertilizers. Or I should try to make fertilizers. Fertilizers, chemicals, paints. Paints. Dyes. And explosives and car batteries. Okay, nitric acid. Nitric acid, HNO3. Nitric acid we use in fertilizers and explosives. Okay. Again, manufacturing of fertilizers and explosives. What you have to write? To manufacture fertilizer and explosives. Like what? TNT. TNT. This is trinitrotoluene. Right? Next, acetic acid. Acetic acid, you know very well, yeah. It's we use like as a vinegar in cooking, and then we use as a food preservative. We use in a vinegar, in cooking, and obviously as a food preservative, right? Food preservative. Right? Okay, next. Now, let's start basis. Bases are what? Bases are the substances which have bitter taste and they are soapy in touch, right? They are soapy in nature. Yes, Aditya. Done, beta. Okay. Bases are bitter in taste and soapy touch. They have soapy touch. And then they turn red.
Red litmus to blue.
Very good. Correct. Red to blue. So what we have learned a short form for this? RBR. No. BRB. Wait. BRB. BRB. Right. Base turn red to blue. That means base turns red litmus paper to blue. Right? Okay, now you know that if suppose I have a gas, ammonia gas, if suppose I'm talking ammonia gas, and I'm saying that ammonia is highly alkaline, like highly basic, okay? Will it be able to turn red litmus paper to blue?
No.
Meghna answered me, Prabhat answered me, I'm waiting for others' answer. You know, guys, we are 75, okay? And I just have received two or three answers. Good, right? Right, because this NH3 gas cannot convert red litmus paper to blue. So what is the very important thing here? This NH3 needs an aqueous medium. NH3 needs an aqueous medium. Yes, Surya, it is a gas. Read your question properly, beta. Okay, listen your question properly. So NH3 needs NH3 gas, ammonia gas needs some aqueous medium. Aqueous medium means what? The medium of water, correct? Then only it will be able to get one hydrogen ion from here, right? It will accept hydrogen ion from here and it will convert into ammonium ion, NH4 positive. And this ammonium ion is basic. It will turn red litmus paper to blue, right? Okay, good. Correct. Yes, good. That was also a question in some year of board exam. I don't remember exactly the year. But yeah, that was the question, that why dry NH3 gas cannot convert red litmus to blue. Okay, chalo, acidity of a base. Again, the similar sort of thing. Here we will not have so many examples. Here we will see just definition. Guys, please keep your mic on mute. Guys, please keep your mic on mute.
माँ दीदी का सिद्धांत याद रखिए, दीदी का सिद्धांत याद रखिए।
ओके, आर्यन, इट्स ओके, आई हैव म्यूटेड। यस, सूर्या नहीं, आर्यन, मैम, कैन प्योर NH3 एग्जिट इन द लिक्विड फॉर्म विदाउट वाटर? नो, आर्यन, यू नो व्हाट, NH3 इज हाईली अल्कलाइन, व्हाट शुड आई से, हाईली सॉल्युबल इन वाटर, इट इज हाईली सॉल्युबल इन वाटर, सो इफ इट गेट्स लाइक एक्सपोजर इन टू जस्ट अ लिटिल बिट अमाउंट ऑफ वाटर मॉलिक्यूल अराउंड इट, इट विल एब्जॉर्ब द वाटर मॉलिक्यूल. ओके, yes, correct Aditya, you got it now. Okay, so here we are talking about acidity of a base. Acidity, that means it is equal to the number of hydroxide ion, it is equal to the number of hydroxide ion furnished by or released by a base in its aqueous medium after what, after a dissociation, after a complete dissociation, right? So we have monoacidic base, very simple example. What do we have? NaOH, KOH. Why? Because they release only one OH negative ion. One molecule will release only one OH negative ion. Correct? Diacidic. Something went wrong.
CaOH twice.
Acetic. Very good. Calcium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, right? Then we have triacidic. Guys, I need example for triacidic from you.
Aluminium hydroxide.
Very good. And good.
Ferric hydroxide.
Huh, okay. Correct. Good. Excuse me. Okay, then. Okay, one example I'll give you here. BOH thrice. Okay, BOH thrice. Boron hydroxide. Okay. Next. Now, some bases and their use. This is very simple. We all are very well aware about the examples of base and their uses. Yes, chromium is also the correct example, Aditya. Very good.
Excuse me, ma'am. Can you please put back up for a second? I just want to copy those acids now.
Yes, yes, sure. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, now we are going to discuss some use of bases, some industrial use of bases. So what are the common bases we know? We know very well, sodium hydroxide, potassium hydroxide, calcium hydroxide, magnesium hydroxide, and one base which is very weak and which is very common. No problem, Akshita. Okay, yeah. So NaOH, this is what? Sodium hydroxide. Aditya, very good. Only Aditya is answering.
Ma'am, sodium hydroxide is used for the production of this.
Soap. Right? Used in manufacture of soap. Of soap, paper. These two are very important use of NaOH. Okay. Synthetic fibers, or you can say
known as rayon.
Yes, rayon. And this is rayon. Okay, guys, please don't get confused.
Then calcium hydroxide is used for the production of bleaching powder.
Wait. Let me finish sodium hydroxide first, okay? Okay, so these are some uses of sodium hydroxide. Guys, what is the common name of sodium hydroxide? Do you know?
Caustic soda.
Caustic soda.
Very good. Caustic soda. Okay, the sodium hydroxide is what? Caustic soda. Correct. Good. Now, this is also known as what? Your caustic soda. Now the next turn is for potassium hydroxide. Potassium hydroxide. Now, what is the common name of potassium hydroxide? Yes, argon. Also as a fire extinguisher. Correct. Okay. Yes.
Caustic potash.
Correct. Shadruli, if I'm pronouncing it right. Correct answer, beta. Purva, correct. Prabhat, correct. Caustic potash. Okay. There was again a question based on caustic potash. The question was super duper easy, but they have given the name caustic potash instead of KOH. So students were getting confused. What is it exactly? Okay, so do remember all their names, general common names. Caustic potash. Caustic potash, yeah. And this also we use in soap preparation. And you can say in alkaline batteries. Yes, this we use in alkaline batteries. Okay, yeah. Next, what we have? Calcium hydroxide. Calcium hydroxide, CaOH twice. Guys, it's CaOH twice. This we use in a bleaching powder, which Prabhat has already told us, right? Bleaching powder. Manufacturer of bleaching powder.
Bleaching powder.
Yes.
Ma'am, it's also used in whitewashing, right?
Yes, yes, correct. And this also be used in softening of hard water. Okay, bleaching powder, softening of.
But bleaching powder is used, no ma'am, for softening of hard water.
But this is used in the preparation of bleaching powder now. So we instantly prepare that and use in the softening of water because calcium hydroxide is stable.
But it will be the uses of bleaching powder, no ma'am.
But it will be in the uses of calcium hydroxide as well. Calcium hydroxide will also be used in the softening of hard water. Softening of hard water. Just remind me towards the end of the class, okay? I'll just tell you the reaction. Okay, then you will understand how the sequence goes from CaOH twice to bleaching powder and then the softening of hard water. It instantly prepares the bleaching powder and then it softens the water. Next, yes, the very important use we forgot. Neutralizing acid soil, right? Neutralizing.
Ma'am, 1 minute, ma'am. One doubt.
Ha, beta, tell me.
Ma'am, for production of bleaching powder, they are adding Cl2 also, no, ma'am? So it becomes CaOCl2. So how then we can use that as uses of calcium hydroxide, ma'am? Softening of hard water.
Correct. Very good doubt, beta. 1 minute, I'll explain. Neutralizing acid in the soil. 1 second, Guys, what is the common name of this calcium hydroxide?
Slaked lime.
Slaked lime.
Yes, slaked lime. Correct. Oh, where should I write? Okay, So what is the name? Prabhat, I think you asked me the doubt, right? Okay, you know, Prabhat, we when we soft, what should I say? When we soften hard water with the help of this calcium hydroxide, that is known as lime softening. Okay, that is known as lime softening. When you have higher content of chlorine in the water, okay, then that time this calcium hydroxide react with the chlorine and form the bleaching powder and then it soften it. That is a different process. But there is another process in which only calcium hydroxide simply can be used to soften the water without any formation of bleaching powder. Okay, that is known as lime soda ash softening. Okay, calcium hydroxide and then what we are using? Soda ash. What is the chemical formula of soda ash? Don't tell me, guys. Chemical formula of soda ash? Yes. Correct. Now, I'm asking formula of soda ash, Na2CO3, iron, tandem, very good. Yes, so this process is known as what? Lime soda ash softening of water, okay? Aditi, you have sent me something. Wait, beta, I have to see. Oh, now it's visible. Oh my God. Okay, so Aditi, your message is what? Ma'am, isn't the washing soda used for... Good question, Aditi. Yes. So Aditi, see here, you know, when we have, bleaching powder, the main purpose of bleaching powder is what? Use as a disinfectant. Okay, we use bleaching powder as in the disinfectants for the purification of water, basically, right? But it's, if the water is very hard, then it can be used as a softening purpose. But that water will not be drinkable. Okay, water will convert into the soft water, but that water will not be drinkable. Okay? So that's why we don't recommend that bleaching powder should be used in the softening of water. Okay, and also you know what it will do? It will form precipitates into the water. Why? Because the calcium salt, what it is going to form in the water, that will not be soluble, right? Yeah. Okay, good. Okay, next we have classification of acids and bases. So guys, classification of acids and bases, you know very well. I'm not going into the too much of detail, right? As we have a lot to do. So let's discuss the superficial things. This presentation is also available in Learnest. So you guys can refer the full presentation from there, okay? So on the basis of origin of acids, acids are divided into organic acid and mineral acid. Mineral acids are also known as what? Inorganic acids, correct? And organic acids are derived from living organisms and all. We have already discussed about it, right? On the basis of strength, bases are classified into strong base and weak base. Acids are also classified into strong acid and weak acid. Don't worry at all, okay? So strong bases are what? Those which completely dissociate into its ions in aqueous solution. That's the important thing, in aqueous solution, right? And weak bases are the bases which cannot dissociate completely, but dissociate partially into the aqueous solution. The best example is NH4OH. And strong bases, for the strong bases, we have examples like KOH, NaOH, right? Yeah. Now, on the basis of the concentration, acids can be classified into dilute acid and concentrated acid. Dilute acid and concentrated acid, right? you know what, this division or this classification is based on the comparative study. Okay, this is a comparative study. When you have low concentration of acid in the aqueous solution, that will be your comparatively dilute solution, right? Vice versa for concentrated acid, correct? Similarly, you can classify bases also, okay? Come back to the another point. On the basis of number of hydrogen ion present in the acid, monoprotic, diprotic, triprotic, and polyprotic, okay? So Surya, I think you got your answer here. Polyprotic, if it has three replaceable hydrogen, it can be known as triprotic, okay? So diprotic, monoprotic, triprotic, and polyprotic, that also we have discussed, depends upon how many replaceable hydrogens you have, right? Now, number of hydroxyl ion or hydroxide ion, monobasic, dibasic, tribasic, polybasic, that also we have discussed, right? Okay, next. Now we have the first question. 15 ml of water and 10 ml of sulfuric acid are to be mixed in a beaker. Okay. Is it the method? What should we follow? And what is this process called? So tell me the first answer. What should we follow? What should be the method? You can tell me in short, beta. I know it will take time to write here. Okay, Prabhat first. No, Purva first answer. Very good, beta. Yes, correct. So what do you have to write here? The acid to be added slowly. Answer A. The acid to be added slowly in water to prevent what? To prevent the mixture to be splashed, right? Okay, this reaction is highly exothermic, you know, right? So the reaction is what? The reaction is highly exothermic. Guys, I can't see your messages right now because I'm writing here. So if you have any doubt now, you can unmute and ask, okay? The reaction is highly exothermic. Therefore, constant cooling should be done, right? Right? Now, what is the next? What is this process called? So you all are very well aware, na? I saw a few answers. Yes, Shreyas, glass beaker from the breaking. Very good, beta. Correct. This could be again another reason. Ma'am, can you see? Aryan, yes, beta, I know. But you know what's happening with me? I can't focus on both the sides. If I'm writing here and you know my handwriting, yeah, right? So if I'm writing on the board here, I can't pay attention on my phone. Yes, okay. So this process is known as what? Dilution. So you have to write properly, okay? Just don't leave with the dilution word. This process is dilution. Okay, next. Now we have indicators. Okay, indicators mean what? Which indicates the presence of acid or base in a solution, right? So the first indicator what we have, litmus paper, it is obtained from a plant known as lichen plant, correct? And you know very well that we extracted from the lichen plant and then we have different kind of, methods like litmus solution, litmus paper, right? Okay, coming to the next point. So other examples are what? Red cabbage, turmeric, and colored petals of what? Colored petals of flower known as petunia, if I'm pronouncing it right. Then hydrangea. And gentian, is it right? I'm pronouncing it right?
It's more like geranium.
Geranium, okay. Huh, yeah, thank you. So there are three flowers and one red cabbage and turmeric. So these are what? And didymus also. These are what? Natural indicators. These comes under the category of natural indicators, right? Obviously, because it is available naturally. Correct? Out of this, this year we didn't do face-to-face classes now. So if we meet next year, then I'll show you red cabbage experiment. If I have done this with Indranagar guys or YPR guys, I don't remember. But if we'll meet next year, we'll do this experiment. Okay, it's very beautiful. So many. Shreyas, I'm coming back to that point as well. Those also comes in the category of natural indicator only, beta. Don't worry, okay? Yeah? Yes. Next, what we have, olfactory indicator. Olfactory indicators are also part of the natural indicator only, okay? It depends upon what? Depends upon the order of the, what do you have, your substances, right? So it shows change in order, not actually it shows, okay? But order changes in acidic medium or in basic medium. That's how it indicates. Onion, clove, and vanilla. Vanilla is also there, okay? So the odor remains in the substance if you are having acidic medium. But if you use these substances in the basic media, then what happened? Then odor goes off, right? Okay, so these are some natural indicators. Apart from this, we have some synthetic indicators also. Synthetic indicators, you know the name. One is phenolphthalein and another one is what? Phenolphthalein and most common indicator. I'm asking. Phenolphthalein and methyl orange. Very good. And what is the color of phenolphthalein in acidic medium? Yes, correct. Very good. The color of phenolphthalein in acidic medium is, it is completely colorless and pink in a basic medium. Very good. Correct. And what is the color of methyl orange? I think I must have included it somewhere. Yeah, it's here. Correct. Yes, so it is, phenolphthalein is what? Colorless. Usually it is colorless indicator. And in acidic medium also, it remains colorless. And in basic medium, it is what? In basic medium, it gives pink color. A very beautiful pink color it gives. I have used it in so many times in titration. Yeah. Okay, methyl orange. Methyl orange. Yes, orange, yeah, red, yellow. Okay. So usually methyl orange gives a red or orange color or pink color in acidic medium, okay? And yellow color in basic medium. Pink or red, right? Bright red. Turmeric, you know, it remains yellow in acidic medium and becomes red in basic medium, right? Red litmus paper and blue litmus paper, you guys are aware? Yes, Aditya, wait. Correct, guys. Okay, so don't worry, this presentation is uploaded over there and I will share this full PDF file as well. Okay, so if you have missed something, then don't worry at all. But yes, you can ask me to scroll it up or to scroll it down. Yes, so define olfactory indicator and name two of the substances of olfactory indicators. Yes, Kulsum, you have raised hand. Kulsum, do you have, yeah, do you want to ask me something?
No.
Okay. Yes, so define olfactory indicators and name any two olfactory indicators. So we just have learned about it. How will you answer it in the exam? What are the keywords for this? Those substances whose smell or odor changes in acidic medium or basic medium. So answer for A. By the way, this was the question of 2015. And the question what we have done before, that was also from 2015. So those substances whose smell, guys, I'm not able to see your messages. Wait, please hold on. Let me finish this. Changes in acidic medium and basic medium. Are called as olfactory indicator, Right? Example, onion, vanilla, clove. Okay, yeah, okay. Now, see, the next question is super duper easy, right? Choose a strong acid from the following.
H2SO4.
Yeah.
H2CO3 and HNO. No, H2SO4 and HNO3.
Yes, H2SO4 and HNO3, correct. Hey, wait, somebody asked me one question. Does red litmus and blue litmus paper turns to neutral in purple in neutral solution? Yes, Aryan, yes, that happens. Yes, Aryan, okay, it happens. Even we are going to see one question based on this. Okay, the question is related that you will have one litmus paper only and then you have to identify acid, base and neutral. Okay, so this technique will be useful in that question. Okay, next, acid base indicators done. Then another problem what we have, a gas produced in the laboratory is highly soluble in water. Its colorless solution turns pink when a few drop of phenolphthalein is added to it. What is the nature of this gas? Oh, so simple. All of you can answer me for this.
Base.
Yes. Only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 answers. Please, guys. Yes, Ranjini, Ghor, Siddharth, Arundhati, correct. Navya, yes. Varsha, Anirudh, Aryan, Tandon, where are you? And Neha, where are you? Aditi, Avni, Aniket. Guys, are you sleeping? What's going on? Now it's good. Okay. So the definitely nature of the color is nature of the gas is what? Base, right? Basic. It's basic. Okay. Done. So answer for this is gas is basic in nature. Okay, gas is basic in nature. And you know what is the gas? That's ammonia. Yeah, because ammonia is only highly soluble basic gas. Okay, okay, next. That was the question of 2014. chemical properties of acid and bases, right? So acid react with metal to form salt and hydrogen gas, correct? Acid react with metal to form salt and hydrogen gas. Aditya, when NH3 react with water, it gives ammonium ion. Ammonium ion. NH4 positive. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Next. Acid plus metal form salt and water. Like HCl plus zinc gives ZnCl2 plus hydrogen gas. Right. You can refer all these reactions. All are very easy. See the last one. This is the formula of acetic acid. Acetic acid react with zinc to form zinc acetate and hydrogen gas. Zinc acetate and hydrogen gas. Okay. You know what? When this reaction happens, so obviously there is a gas released. How will you detect that the reaction has got over, or how will you detect that the gas is hydrogen? What is the test name here to detect the hydrogen? Yes, correct. Correct. INR guys, are you sleeping? Answer me here. Where are you? Are you having your snacks? Yes, yes, correct. Yes, Navya, Akshita, Navya, Flame, correct. Srushti. Correct. So we have the test name is pop test. Pop test. Okay. When we use a burning candle or burning a sphincter in front of the test tube, okay, it burns with a pop sound. If the gas is what? If the gas is hydrogen gas, because hydrogen burns with a pop sound. Right? Okay. So this pop test, again, we are going to see in some question. Okay, now chemical properties, as we are learning chemical properties of acid and bases. So what happens when a base react with a metal? Again, when a base react with a metal, it forms salt and hydrogen gas. Simple, right? Okay, so next what we have, see the question here. 2 ml of sodium hydroxide solution is added to a few pieces of granulated zinc. Sodium hydroxide to granulated zinc, okay? Taken in the test tube. When the content are warmed, a gas evolved. Okay, which is bubbled through the soap solution before testing. Write the equation, chemical equation involved here. And what is the name of the gas detected in the test tube? Then name of the gas which has evolved. And the name of the gas which will be evolved when the same metal react with dilute or strong acid. Oh, I can see so many messages are there. Really? One. Mm-hmm. Let's see. Okay, okay, okay. Yes, sodium zincate will be formed, correct? Yeah, correct. But what will be the reaction, beta? You have to tell me the reaction. How are you going to write this in exam? You know, this is the question of 2018, I guess. Yeah, this is the question of 2018. And 2 marker, yes. Okay, so see, how will you write this? Okay, when the sodium hydroxide solution is heated with the zinc granules and all, the reaction will be
The reaction will be NaOH plus Zn gives Zn Na2 ZnOH plus H2 gas.
Very good. When NaOH solution is heated with granulated zinc. Okay, now guys, you know, they don't repeat so many questions. Okay, they repeat the question, then they create some little bit of twist in the question. Correct? What I'm talking about, the board exams and the examiners, right? Okay, so if they twist the question, what kind of twist they can create? See, in this question, they might ask that why do we use this granulated zinc? Or what should we use, the granulated zinc or the chips of zinc or the powdered zinc or a thick metal strip of zinc? So what we have to use or what should we use? The first preferable is, very good Aditya, correct. First preferable thing is powdered zinc. If you do not have powdered zinc in the option, then granulated zinc. Then the small chips of zinc metal. Or then the last one should be what? Last one is the zinc metal, okay? Because the granulated or the powdered zinc, that means the surface area of zinc is increasing. So there will be more surface area provided to react with your acid or base, correct? So zinc metal, then sodium zincate and hydrogen gas are formed. Sodium zincate and hydrogen gas are formed, right? Equation is what? 2NaOH plus this, then Na2ZnO2 plus H2. Yeah, you must be thinking, ma'am, how do you know that two molecules of NaOH would be required? Because I remember the formula of sodium zincate. Na2Zn plus ZnO2. Na2ZnO2. This is the formula, right? So here I need two sodium. So I just have kept two here. Okay. Yeah. 2NaOH plus Zn gives Na2ZnO2 and hydrogen gas. Now, what is the test for hydrogen? Oh God, I don't have a space. Okay. So see here, the test I'm writing here again. I'll erase it. Will it be fine? Surya, what is the question, beta? Ma'am, could you show how it is formed during the reaction? Means what, Surya? I couldn't understand. Can you unmute?
And how do we obtain this formula, Na2ZnO2? Like, how is it obtained during this reaction?
How do we? Are it simple thing. See, what happens? First, it will form Na positive and OH negative, right? This OH negative is going to react with zinc, but here we have zinc and here we have sodium. Sodium is more reactive than zinc, definitely, right? So sodium will try to pull OH towards sodium and zinc will try to pull OH towards zinc, right? Now in this condition, what is going to happen? It will break. OH bond will break from here, okay? OH bond will break and then this H plus ion will again react the another H plus ion of the OH, okay? And this NaO will react with your zinc, okay? And that's how it forms this formula, sodium zincate. Got it?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, beta, welcome. So let's do the pop test. Okay, guys, now I need to increase our speed because it's 5-2 and we have to do solves. Which slide I am doing, by the way, right now? Oh my God, I am doing 21st slide. And you know what? We have 50 slides, I guess. Okay, what is the pop test or the test for hydrogen? Test for hydrogen. You know what? A splint or what should I say? A burning candle we can held near the opening of test tube. burning is flint or a burning candle. Once again. Is to be held near the opening of test tube, obviously where the gas is releasing, okay? Then the stopper is removed. Then the stopper is removed to expose the splint to the gas, right? The stopper is removed. If the gas is flammable or if the gas is hydrogen, the splint will burn with pop sound, correct? If the gas is hydrogen, splint will burn with pop sound. With pop sound, okay? So this thing proves that hydrogen gas burns with the pop sound. Now, what they have given us, what they have asked us in the last sentence, the name of the gas which will evolve when the same metal react with the dilute or strong acid. So let's say the same metal, zinc, is reacting with H2SO4 and it forms what? ZnSO4 plus hydrogen gas again, right? Here we have to burn it. And remember, when we have written NaOH reaction, right? NaOH with zinc, that also we have to heat a bit, okay? We have to warm the test tube, correct? Okay, next. You know that the metal which can displace hydrogen from the dilute acid is known as active metals, like sodium, potassium, zinc, iron and all, right? So the active metal which lies above the hydrogen in activity series, only those can replace hydrogen, okay? Those are more reactive as compared to hydrogen, and those can replace hydrogen from the acid, and in the result, the hydrogen gas evolved, right? Next, this one is important. Attention. Sorry?
Ma'am, the slide said that metals that lie above hydrogen are electropositive in nature. But aren't even metals like mercury and copper, even though they lie below hydrogen, aren't they also electropositive?
Yes, correct. They are also electropositive in nature. But if you go top to bottom, electropositivity decreases.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, there is no issue. If you want to remove this word from here, you can remove it. No worries. Okay, you can say simply that the metals before hydrogen, they are more active than the hydrogen. Or you can say they are more electropositive than the hydrogen. Okay, are more electropositive, I should write here. Okay?
Yes.
More electropositive in nature. Yeah.
Thank you.
So their atom can lose electron very easily. Okay, yeah. Next. If the dilute nitric acid is used, okay, in the place of HCl, dilute nitric acid, okay, HNO3 is used in the HCl or is used in the place of HCl or H2SO4, hydrogen gas will not be evolved. Why? You know why? Because the nitric acid is very strong oxidizing agent and it oxidizes hydrogen into water. Okay, then what happened? Because it is converting hydrogen into water. So your final contain should have water instead of hydrogen, right? Okay, and see, it oxidizes hydrogen into water and itself gets reduced to an oxide of nitrogen, such as dinitrogen oxide, nitrogen monoxide, nitrogen dioxide, okay? Okay, so usually metal does not release hydrogen in presence of nitric acid. What is the reason? Because it is very strong oxidizing agent. But there are few metals like magnesium, manganese, they react with dilute nitric acid and they release HNO3 because that reduces the power of oxidizing power of HNO3. Okay. Okay, guys, next slide. Yes, when acid react with metal carbonates, when acid react with Shobita, not only magnesium and manganese, okay? Because the metal which reduces oxidizing property of the HNO3 will produce hydrogen. Because manganese and magnesium, they are, what should I say? They reduces the oxidizing property of HNO3. Okay? Next. When acid react with metal carbonates, it form carbon dioxide. Guys, do remember, whenever you have carbonates, bicarbonates, anything, okay, definitely in end of the reaction, this acid-base reaction, you will have carbon dioxide, okay, because this CO3 is going to form CO2, okay, yeah, so Na2CO3 reacts with HCl to form NaCl and H2O. Similarly, NaHCO3, which is metal bicarbonate, sodium bicarbonate, it reacts with HCl to form NaCl, CO2 and H2O. Okay? Okay, the next thing. You know what? The eggshell, chalk, marble, they all contain calcium carbonate, right? So they also react with acid. Okay? See, the marble also react with acid. So if you see that acid has got spilt over the marble or something, you will see some bubbles will come out over there because that marble is reacting with your concentrated acid part. Okay. Next, if the person is suffering from acidity, if the person is suffering from acidity, then doctor advised to take baking soda, right? I don't remember, but suppose we do not have baking soda, then what other thing can we have in the case of acidity? This is my question from you.
Milk of magnesia.
Yes, milk of magnesia, correct. There was something else. Yes, milk of magnesia is fine. Yeah, milk of magnesia is fine, but there was something else. Let me just think. What is that? If the person... Oh, no, sorry, my mistake. You know, the question was, if the person has suffering from that bee sting or ant sting, and if you don't have soda at home, what can you use to treat it? What should be the first thing? Yeah, that was the question I have seen. Any idea, any guess? Surya, bee sting or ant sting contain formic acid, and if you are using saliva is also slightly acidic. Yes, Aditya, my question is, you know what, if we do not have NaHCO3, if we do not have sodium bicarbonate at home, baking soda if we don't have. Yes, so Surya, Aryan, both are right, and Shreyas, water and dilute acid. Nahi, Shreyas, that you can't use dilute acid. Water is fine, but you can't use dilute acid, okay? Yes, Ranjini, but where will you search the leaves of dock plant over there? Yeah? Prishim is the nice name if I'm pronouncing it right. Yes, now it is fine. Correct, guys, yes, we can use toothpaste, and we can use toothpaste, and we can use soap. Okay, the best option is what? Soap. Okay, soap and toothpaste we can apply over that area where the burning sensation is happening, right? Next, explain the action of dilute hydrochloric acid on the following chemicals. So magnesium ribbon, sodium hydroxide, and crushed eggshell. You guys know very well, and you can answer it by your own. Okay, after this class, I'm going forward. Surya milk doesn't contain lactic acid, beta. Sour milk contains lactic acid. Okay. But even though milk will also increase acidity because it is sometimes hard to digest lactose from the milk. That increases acidity. Okay. It's not like that milk contains lactic acid. Milk doesn't contain. Sour milk contains lactic acid. Okay, next, chemical properties. In this, we have lime water test. There was again a question. Wait, yeah, see, on passing excess carbon dioxide gas through the lime water, the first turn milky and then becomes colorless. Explain why. Write all the chemical equation in the reaction involved. So, see, on passing excess of carbon dioxide through the lime water, first of all, what will be the reaction of carbon dioxide through lime water? This is also known as lime water test, test for CO2, right? On passing SO2 gas evolved through the lime water, okay? Evolved through the lime water. On passing S carbon dioxide gas through the lime water, it converts into calcium carbonate. Calcium carbonate is what? Calcium carbonates are insoluble white precipitates, okay? So that's why our solution becomes milky, right? Now, if we pass excess of carbon dioxide, then what happens? Calcium carbonate, water, and carbon dioxide, they all will react. And it forms calcium bicarbonate, which is soluble in water. So your milky appearance goes off, right? Okay, so this should be the complete answer for this. On passing excess of carbon dioxide gas through milky, through lime water, first, it turns to milky and then it becomes colorless because it forms calcium bicarbonate, which is soluble in water. Okay. Very good, guys. Correct. Good. Now it is again related to the same thing what we have learned. I'm moving to the next part. Now, what is universal indicator? What is universal indicator? You know very well, right? What is universal indicator? Universal indicators, that means the indicator or the mixture of synthetic indicators, which is used to find the pH of the solution, right? Answer for A. Mixture of synthetic indicators. Oh my God, I didn't change the color of this pen. Indicators, which is used to find pH of solutions, right? And it gives results in wide range of pH. pH 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, up to 14, it shows change in color, right? So this is the basically universal indicator. Write the chemical equation involving the preparation of sodium hydroxide. So this is actually belongs to the salt part, but let's discuss it here as well. Very good, guys. Aryan, yes. Aditya, yes. Akshita, good. Correct, beta. So NaCl, the B part is what? Equation R. What equation can we write? NaCl, common salt, which is used to prepare sodium hydroxide. And this process name is what? Chloralkali, NaCl plus H2O. And what do? We provide electricity. Electricity, right? And it converts into chlorine, alkali, NaOH, and hydrogen gas. Okay? So, chloralkali process, this is known as chloralkali process. Why? Because it prepares chlorine as well as NaOH. This chlorine can be further used to prepare bleaching powder. Okay. Yes, correct, guys. Next. Oh, this was the question of, my God, this was the question of 2012, the previous one. Is it the following, is it the reason for following statements? Okay, so guys, I'm going a little fast now because I have to increase my speed now. Okay, the stain of curry on a white cloth become reddish brown when a soap is scrubbed on it. Okay, when a soap is scrubbed on it, and it turns yellow again when the cloth is washed with the plenty of water. So what happens in this condition? Like why, how this happened, why this happens? Because when we rub soap over the cloth, okay, when we rub the cloth with the soap, soap contains NaOH. So that curry turns into yellow color because turmeric react with the sodium hydroxide and gives yellow color, correct? And then when we wash it off with the plenty of water, again the soap part or the basic part removed, gets removed from the turmeric. So it comes back to the previous color, correct? So how will we write it? Answer for the first one, turmeric react with sodium hydroxide present in the soap to form red color. Red color compound. It turns yellow again because sodium hydroxide becomes very, sodium hydroxide will be diluted in case of lot of water, right? It turns yellow. It turns yellow again because NaOH becomes very diluted, or NaOH will be very diluted. I should write properly here. Is somebody is asking something? With lot of water in that. Yeah? Any question, beta? Next, curd should not be kept into the copper vessel. Why? Oh my God, Aditya, very good. Curd consists of lactic acid and react with a metal. Yes, Ralph, correct. Yes, correct. So the curd contains lactic acid, which react with the copper vessel or the brass vessel, right? And the taste of curd changes. So it should not be kept into the copper vessel or brass vessel, right? Because curd contains lactic acid. This was a question of 2016. Okay, 2016 question. Curd contains lactic acid and it reacts with copper and brass. So where should we store curd then? Okay, so we should store curd in glass. Yes, glass container, correct.
Ma'am, could we also write a reason as curd reacts with copper and brass and produces harmful salts which can cause like food poisoning?
Which will cause?
Food poisoning.
Oh, no. That salt doesn't cause food poisoning. long-term consumption of will disturb your stomach.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, yeah. Okay, what is done to be protected? So we should store curd in glass container, okay? Curd should be stored in glass container. Guys, this I have tried personally myself. Seriously, we should not store curd even in steel container. I know the steel is alloy and it doesn't react, but still I felt that the taste of curd gets changed if I store it for a day or two. Yeah, plastic is, Surya, again, I didn't find plastic good for that curd storage. I found glass is very well, like, No. You know, Aryan, what happens? That protective layer of aluminum oxide is also very thin. If sometime you scratch it with the spoon, now that layer will come out. And then aluminum oxide is not good for health. Okay, Aryan? Yeah? Seriously, Aditya still reacts with them in the beginning. Huh, Surya, that matka is also the good option. Okay, guys, coming back to the point, it's 524. Neutralization reaction. You know, neutralization reaction is again so simple. Base and acid react to form salt and water. So when a base reacts with acid, it will form a respective salt and water. Okay, neutralization reaction takes place when the effect of base is nullified by the acid and vice versa, obviously. Correct? So if suppose you have a red litmus paper, and you are using a basic solution. So red litmus paper will be turned to blue, correct? Now, if you are using a neutral solution, that blue litmus paper will be turned to purple, right? The blue litmus paper will be turned to what? Purple. Why? Because you are using a neutral solution. Nahi, Arya, there is no compulsion like that, okay? Don't worry. If we are not able to finish it, the salt part I will do in the next class. It's not compulsory, Aryan. It's not compulsory. Don't worry. I have planned according to that, but it's not compulsory, right? Okay. Now, do you know here? Do you know here what I was thinking to tell you? It's related to your neutralization reaction. No problem, Navya. So here, do you know here what I was thinking to write? That how to dilute an acid. Okay, you know very well that it is advisable to add acid into water. Add acid into water to dilute it, right? Not water into acid. You know the reasons, right? Because it is very exothermic reaction. We have to prevent the splash, right? We have to stop splashing of the acid. If you add water into acid, it will splash out. Yes, it can also break the beaker. Correct. Correct. Next. So it's okay, then leave it. Next. Yes, reaction of metal oxide with acids. Reaction of metal oxide with acid. Any example from you guys? Okay. Salt and water release. Are guys, I'm asking. Oh, reaction of metal oxide with acid. Any example you can give me? Yes, Shobita, very good. Thank you. You are the one only who answered me. HCl plus calcium oxide. It gives CaCl2 plus H2O, right? Next example, it could be your CaO plus H2SO4. right? It will give you CaSO4.
NaCl plus HCl. No, NaOH plus HCl.
NaOH, beta, it's a base. And we are talking about metal oxide. NaOH is a base, beta. Isn't it? Right? You can use MgO, NaO, anything is fine. H2SO4, it gives MgSO4 plus water.
Ma'am, is this possible? NaO plus HCl?
NaO plus HCl is, theoretically it is possible. Practically it is not possible. Okay, because sodium oxide is highly unstable, it will immediately react with the water to form NaOH. Right? So theoretically it's not possible. Oh, sorry. What did I say? Practically, it is not possible. Yeah. Okay. But you know, the formula is also for NaO. It's not NaO actually. It should be Na2O. Na2O. Okay. Na2O plus HCl. So it gives NaCl plus H2O. And obviously, it should be your HCl. Yeah, then it is balanced. But it is theoretically possible thing. Right? Next. Reaction of non-metallic oxide with a base. Now you all are aware of this thing, that metallic oxides are what? Metallic oxides are known as basic oxides. Metallic oxides are known as basic oxides, right? And non-metallic oxides are acidic oxides, correct? Non-metallic oxides are acidic oxides. So what's happening here? Non-metallic oxide, CaOH twice, how? Something wrong, I think I have pasted here. Non-metallic oxide, okay. What could be the reaction with non-metallic oxides? Oh, sorry, non-metallic oxide with a base, it's right. Non-metallic oxide with a base. So carbon dioxide with a base, okay. Calcium hydroxide, it gives calcium carbonate and water. So non-metallic oxide react with a base and it forms salt and water. that says that your non-metallic oxides are acidic in nature, right? Acidic in nature because they produce salt and water. Okay, next. Huh. No. Rudpurva, see, the Ca is, CaOH is the base and non-metallic oxide is the carbon dioxide. Okay. Yeah. Carbon dioxide. Next. What will you observe when sulfur dioxide is passed through water and lime water? Yes, this question was there in 2016 or 2015 exam. Yeah. So, what will you observe when it is passed through sulfur? Seriously, good, very good. Okay. Waiting for others' answers. Okay. Yes, correct. So see here, the first question answer, the A part. It will form sulfurous acid. It is sulfurous acid. Okay. See here. Sulfurous acid is formed. Okay. So here SO2 plus H2O gives H2SO3. Okay. H2SO3, you know, it is sulfurous acid, right? When this SO2 is passed through the lime water, then what will happen? SO2, lime water is, you know, CaOH twice, correct? It converts into what? CaSO3, calcium sulfide. SO3 is what? Sulfide and H2O. So calcium sulfide, PHATE. Okay. So remember one thing, whenever SO2 react with water, it gives you some compound based on SO3. Some compound based on SO3, which have combination of SO3. Okay. SO3 is what? SO3 is basically known as your sulfite ion. SO3 2 minus sulfite. TE, right? SO4 2 minus, you know, sulfate. S2 minus is sulfide. Sulfide. Got it? No confusion? Aditya, you can calculate its oxidation number, beta. It is 2 minus oxygen and it is 2 plus here. Now calculate the oxidation number of sulfur. You will get its valency. Minus 6 plus 2. Sulfur is plus 4 here, I guess. Plus 4 or minus 4, 1 minute. Minus 6. Minus 4. Sulfur is plus 4 here. Okay. Yeah. Next. Okay, guys. So I think from the pH solution, we will be doing in the next class. Okay. I don't know when we have next class schedule. I'll just check the schedule. The next topic is written for the next class, but I will change it. And from the pH, we will be doing in the next class. Okay. Okay, everybody, did you understand? Any question, any doubt, anything?
Ma'am, you said that at the last, you will tell the formula of that bleaching powder and all.
Welcome, Magna. Welcome, beta. Prabhat, you be in the class 1 minute, okay? Initially, what was the topic, Navya? The topic was metals and non-metals. Okay, now we will be continuing from the pH and then we'll continue from the metal. Like once we end this chapter, then we will do metals. Yeah. Okay. Prabhat, your doubt is welcome, Ralph. Ralph and Ranjini, Navya, Aryan. Thank you guys. Welcome. Bye-bye. Enjoy your day. Hope you understood everything. Thank you, Shares, Akshita, Shobita. Bye-bye, beta. Bye, Shalini. Bye, Avni. Bye, Navya. Bye, Aryan. Bye. Bye, Anishka. Bye, Neha. Nisha. Sorry. Bye, Nisha. Bye, Ananya. Yes. So, Prabhat, you were asking something, beta?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I was asking, you said that you'll tell at the last of the class the formula of bleaching powder and how it is formed.
Let's discuss that. Thank you, Rutpurva. Very nice compliment. So sweet of you. And feel free to ask your doubts. You can post your doubts in the forum, okay? Or your in respective WhatsApp group or Moxtra group. Okay, Eden. Bye. Bye, Nandini. Welcome. So, Prabhat, see, the question was bleaching powder formation and cleaning of water or softening of water, something like that, I remember, right?
Yes, ma'am.
See here, if suppose you have, you know, in water, we have certain ions, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, if your water is very hard, in your water, if you have calcium, magnesium, what is the composition of hard water? The salt of calcium and magnesium, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So I'll share the another screen here. Wait. So you know what happens when you use calcium hydroxide with your hard water? What happens? Hard water. If the water contains amount of chlorine, if water has some amount of chlorine, it reacts with chlorine, it forms CaOCl2. Okay, it forms CaOCl2. And then it uses for the softening of water, CaOCl2, I guess. Something like that, is it? Yeah. Okay, then we use it for the softening of water. Now, you know what? When bleaching powder is used, has been treated with the water, anything, hard water, soft water, anything is fine. The main purpose of bleaching water is what? The disinfectant. If you leave the disinfectant part as well, that's fine. But what will happen when it gets dissolved in the water, it will release some amount of chlorine in the water, right? So now what happened? With softening of water, your water is not is having high content of chlorine. Still, this water is not drinkable. Are you getting my point? Are you getting my point? Hello, Prabhat. Beta, am I
audible? Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So what is our purpose? The purpose is the water will be disinfectant, like water will be completely free from the germs, but it is not drinkable. So we use calcium, not the calcium hydroxide, we use this bleaching powder for the disinfectant purpose. Right? Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
This is the way of softening of water. But usually calcium hydroxide, you ask me, ma'am, how can we use calcium hydroxide for that? So calcium hydroxide is used with the sodium bicarbonate and it softens the water. That process is known as lime soda water softening, if you remember I told.
Yeah, ma'am.
Right? Okay, now tell me again, what is your doubt, beta?
Cleared, ma'am.
Done? Okay.
Yes.
Fine. So, Prabhat is done. Kiran,
thank you, ma'am.
Any question? Aryan, Aditya, welcome, beta. Aniket, any question, any doubt? Okay, guys, enjoy New Year. Bye bye. See you in the next class. Yeah, bye. Okay, bye.